ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಐ ಮಸ್ಟ್ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಸೇ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಲುಕಿಂಗ್ ಅರೌಂಡ್ ದ ಫೇಸಸ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ರೂಮ್ ಫುಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅನ್ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿಕ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅನ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪರ್ಟ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾಸ್ ನ್ಯೂ ಆಕ್ಟಿವ್ ಅರ್ಬನ್ ಸಿಟಿಸನ್ಸ್ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ಸ್ ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಅಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಫ್ರೇಮ್ಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ರೀಫ್ರೇಮ್ಡ್ ಆಲ್ ದ ಟೈಮ್ ಸೊ ಅಟ್ ಅರ್ಘ್ಯಮ್ ವಿ ವರ್ಕ್ ಇನ್ ವಾಟರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಸ್ಯಾನಿಟೇಷನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಥ್ರೂ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಡನ್ ಸಮ್ ವರ್ಕ್ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಅರ್ಬನ್ ಸ್ಪೇಸ್ ಸೊ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಶೇರಿಂಗ್ ಸಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಕನ್ಸರ್ನ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಕೇಮ್ ಅಪ್ ಇನ್ ಆರ್ ವರ್ಕ್ ಎಸ್ಪೆಷಲಿ ಇನ್ ಅ ಟೌನ್ ಕಾಲ್ ಮುಲ್ಬಾಗಲ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ 100 kilometers ಔಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಯರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ಮೇಡ್ ಅ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಷನ್ ಅಟ್ ಬರ್ಕ್ಲಿ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಆನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ವಿ ಬಿಗ್ಯಾನ್ ಟು ಲರ್ನ್ ಸಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಇಶ್ಯೂಸ್ ಫೇಸಿಂಗ್ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಟೌನ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಸೊ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಐ ಕುಡ್ ಈವನ್ ಫ್ರೇಮ್ ದ ಹೋಲ್ presentation the way you did, you know, the institutional arrangements, the pricing points. But let me just try to say that I think in the good old days, I think people used to settle around water resources. And perhaps water used to be the organizing principle around which we would have human settlements. Now, since that idea is divorced, now we now need to bring water to wherever people are. And that's why the whole urban paradigm in India has become like that. That you bring water from far away. Everyone knows these issues. It's very expensive to do so. We know water flows very nicely downstream, but if you wanted to go up, you have to use a lot of energy to do that. And here in Bangalore, this water comes from 100 kilometers away. So we shouldn't waste that last drop. So, and a lot of energy cost in this water. That's the true ecological cost of this glass. But so how, if we are going to urbanize, we are facing it, urbanization happens in India. And if you are going to say there are 8,000 plus towns and cities, then how are we going to imagine that water, sanitation, sewerage, stormwater, drainage, etc. is going to happen in these towns? The High Power Committee report has some talk of the numbers and outlays, and the imagination of that seems to be coming rather from the imagination is a kind of imagination that happened in Western countries where there seemed to have been an abundance of resources, if not financial, at least natural. And I don't know if we can do that in our 7,000 towns. I think it's impossible I don't even know if there's a realistic assessment of the water itself. So what if we had to reimagine water supply and sanitation, sewerage and storm drainage for urban India? What shape would that imagination take? I think we have to begin that conversation. Are we really going to say that we are going to have large sewage carrying sewerage systems with treatment plants at the other end? CSE has done a lot of work on this, and I'm sure you all are familiar with that. I'm not sure that paradigm is going to hold, or at least the promise will be held out, but on the ground other things will happen. Because in India we have seen that there's a lot of innovation that happens in the informal sector, which is not officially recognized, but it serves local purposes reasonably well, not in a great way, but it does. Whether it is water supply in the slum areas, whether it is water tankers when the Kaveri pipelines are not working and when TG Halli reservoir has failed, there is some service happening, but it never fits into the imagination of the planners. So how can we non-planners and non-economists, together with all the planners and economists, take back this question? So if you were to say in small towns, imagine decentralized, use the principle of subsidiarity. If you're going to have conditionalities, then say, let's use local water first, without which nothing. Let's do some amount of recycling and reuse, otherwise you don't get anything else from somewhere else. I mean, if you do that, if you start that dialogue, then I think there are some really possibilities to rethink. We've done some just back of the envelope calculations, and it's fairly obvious that the cost of production of water supply, when you're taking it from your local resource, for example, the groundwater under your city's land, bringing that up, even if it means recharging, quality issues, etc., is going to be much cheaper than bringing it from a surface source somewhere else. I mean, these are very simple things. And if you're on the banks of a surface water source, then you have that luxury, so long as you don't take your waste and dump it back in there. I mean, if you just had some basic principles like that that we could all agree to, I think you could change the conversations around water supply in Indian towns. And so also a precautionary principle seems like a sensible thing to put into place when you're looking at, I mean, people are imagining the interlinking of rivers, but there is intrabasin transfer planned all the time in states because some new town needs more water, or a big city like Bangalore needs more water, and we finished using up all our local rivers. But it's not going to be sustainable. So go back to very simple things. I don't think it's rocket science to say when the rain falls on your head, harvest it at the right unit. There is a kind of push that every house should catch water, but I'm not sure if that's the unit at which you want to push, because that's a lot of private investment in putting the rainwater stuff on your roof, whereas it might best be collected a little further away at a community level and then resupplied back. But I'm saying that without reimagining water supply and sanitation, we are not going to get very far. Already, if you look at, we know that 80% of India's urban sewage is not treated. And it's going to keep coming. I mean, the more people come into the cities, the more of a sewage problem you're going to have. So what are you going to do? Right now, we have toilets with leach pits, and we have, in the informal economy, unrecognized players who have that one tank which comes and sucks out the waste and takes it away, and has some informal and probably unhygienic contract with some farmer where they go and dump the human waste on that farm, and that's happening all around Bangalore today, and it's happening in other cities and towns. Now, do we want to, the next question about institutional arrangements comes up. What do you want to do with these informal sector players? Do you want to disrecognize them completely? Do you want to find a way to bring them into the formal mainstream? If so, are you going to regulate them so much that you put them out of business? So if you don't start to recognize some of the non-recognized players and build out from there, instead of having a big massive vision of how urban India is going to look 15 years from now, maybe we'll create our own sense of how every citizen can get reasonable water for their personal uses. Right now, intra-city, there is shocking variation. For example, in Delhi, some report said between 36 liters per capita a day to 450 liters per capita per day. I mean, I can use 450 liters pretty easily if I put on my shower at full blast for quite a while and keep flushing all day long. But that's not how you want to imagine the city either. So then you go into pricing issues. What is the true cost of water? I am paying 6 rupees per kiloliter, but the BWSSB uses something, it costs about 17 rupees, something like that, per kiloliter to get it to me. So now, that delta, who's going to pay that? Who should be paying that? I'm not saying necessarily that you make every citizen pay, but define better where that is going to come from. Sometimes I feel that we swing between, if you don't mind with much apologies, the lack of imagination from the supply side players and the highly overactive imagination of some of my activist friends. So where, and some are, might be in this room, but honestly, how do we find that middle ground? Who builds up this idea together? I think it's time to ask these questions about water, because you can live without energy even. But I doubt, you just can't live a healthy, decent, safe life without water. Too many people don't have access even to 20 liters of basic, hygienic, safe water. And even the water that comes, Mr. Ravindra, that comes to my door from the BWSSB, the quality at the point of use may not be exactly what I might want, right? Even though it's chlorinated, I know not very far from where I am. So we are facing quality issues as well. I mean, I could go on and on, but really it's about, I think, reimagining. And my big point is, in 60 years around the country, we have seen so much of work from the civil society together with the local governments to build up the demand side. That has not happened in the urban sector. Civil society has not been active enough in the urban sector. We have to build out the role of non-profit, non-NGO players in urban areas. So before we can really put the amount of pressure, the amount of strategic pressure that needs to be put on the supply side. The demand side is weak, and the its articulation on the supply side is pretty weak. So even in Mulbagal, we saw that we had to spend a lot of time first just talking to citizens and then to people at the ward level, the sanitation committees that we tried to put together, water and sanitation committees. There was no sense that you can do collective action. And I don't see how we can do it without creating people's institutions of collective action. Sounds very old-fashioned, but we need to new forms of that. I'm seeing that happening in big cities like Bangalore, where the residents' welfare associations have become one kind of middle-class pathway towards putting pressure on public policy and on public and on action from the agencies concerned. They've been reasonably successful. But the challenges go beyond what the RWAs or even the ward committees can possibly deal with. A lot of these are in the public spaces, in the places where the commons are. And how are we going to deal with those? The water bodies that are in the commons could become a foundational source, a big important source for our water supply. Who's managing them? There are so many fractured institutions looking at all these things with no authority, not enough responsibility even. How will we bring this together? We have to reimagine it. I don't see it happening without that reimagination. Use local water first. Manage your demand. Get people to understand water a bit better. Do not forget that you need to plan your wastewater along with your water. We can't separate these two things anymore. The public health implications have been horrendous all over the country. I just came from a rapid river, 16 river valleys tour of Uttarakhand. Went through 16 river valleys, 1,500 kilometers in 6 days. The state of our rivers, of course, is worth 7 more conferences. But if you see the towns that dotted those places where all of India goes to wash its sins, you know, Rudraprayag, Alaknanda, Mandakini, Ganga, Yamuna, Bhagirathi. If you see those towns, it's enough to make you cry. Because they're taking the water, they're putting in their waste, and the water supply within the town, right on the banks of the world's mightiest rivers, is not of good sufficient quality. So this really begs the question, whose imagination is playing out in managing our urban water supply? But I would say, as a last point, that yes, there is lots of big ticket reform of the superstructure to be done. But there's a lot of things that are possible to do below the structure and within the structure, which there is no reason why town and municipal corporations cannot take back some of the power, even without waiting for the big ticket reform to happen. And we saw some evidence that it is possible in Mulbagal. And there's a lot of the material up there on the website at Argyam, which you all could look at. And during the conversation, we can talk a little more about it. So I think some stuff can be done today while we keep building up the demand to put pressure to reimagine our water supply in towns all over the country. So thank you. I'll stop with that.